Hello and welcome back to Proactive. I'm very happy to be joined now by Barry Cahill, who is the Executive Director of Cyprium Metals. Barry, great to have you on the line. And I know that you haven't spent too much time talking to our audience here in Europe. So perhaps you could start by getting us up to speed with the Cyprium story.
Thanks for the opportunity to talk about us. So Cyprium Metals was formed about 3 years ago with a strategy to become a mid-tier copper producer within Australia. And in that time, we've managed to accumulate three projects within Western Australia. And we've now gone from zero in terms of a resource to 1.6 million tonnes of copper in resource. And even more exciting, we've got a project called the Nifty Copper Project, which we obtained in the end of April last year in 2021. We've completed a study to restart it. That's a mine that's on care and maintenance, and we're actually in a finance process with a view to doing a refurbishment restart next year and be producing copper by the first half of 2024. So come quite a long way in that short period of time. And as I said, we had a strategy to build a mid-tier copper producer, and Nifty will be the first step in that strategy.
And there's a little bit of a gap in the market in Australia, isn't there, for a mid-tier copper producer?
Yeah, there certainly is. You see even today, Oz Minerals is not mid-tier, certainly, but they're about to be gobbled up by BHP every time a copper producer seems to poke up their head and get a bit of size, they get taken out, which is not surprising considering the copper thematic and what it is at the moment with a, you know, future undersupply and, potentially there's not a lot of quality copper assets out there, or small to mid-tier copper producers. So, yeah, it's almost a vacuum point in the Australian market. And as I said, we're pretty unique. We've built up a reasonable resource size. We've got a near-term project that we can start that, as I said, is a refurbishment and care and maintenance. And we've got those two other projects that we'll get to shovel ready and get them going as well.
Fantastic. So can you give us a little bit more detail about how that financing operation is coming along and what it is you're actually aiming for in terms of numbers?
Yeah, certainly. So what we're aiming to do is to get about 250 million in Australian dollar terms. We've got, we're working on a senior debt package of about 200 million and then an offtake arrangement of about 50 million. So we're advanced, as far advanced as we've ever been. We're close to basically finalising that. And once we do that and the money goes in the bank, we hope to kick off very early next year. I mean, it's running up to Christmas at the moment, so we're probably not going to hit January, which we would have hoped to start, but certainly we'll be aiming to try and get going in February, providing we can get the finance finalised and documents signed and all that. So, and as you can imagine, it's been a bit of a difficult market since we started this process in about April. So it's been a bit slow. A lot of parties have been interested, but obviously, as the market takes its little ups and downs and that, people become more interested or less interested. But I think ultimately the way the copper supply story is looking, I think ultimately the whole market will wake up that, you know, copper development is in short supply. And I think we'll be recognised and rewarded because of that, more in the short term than the long term.
Absolutely. Well, that's going to take me nicely into my final question, really, which is, is your reason for wanting to stick with this project and build it up to do with the fact that you think there is a long-term reward in copper? Because it sounds like you're keen to avoid just generating a new project and selling it to one of the big boys.
Yeah, certainly. So our background is strongly being construction, development, construction and operations. So we're not explorers. We don't go around drilling holes in deserts and things like that. That's not our skill set. But we want to be a developer, we want to operate, and we want to build projects, and as I said, we want to become mid-tier. The other thing about our strategy is we also produce copper cathode, so we're not a concentrate producer. We have a bit of intellectual property around heat leach, and ultimately we want to be a copper cathode producer. The reason for that is it's much, much more commercial than producing concentrate and then shipping it overseas to another country who then generates a cathode. And you can see in the market, when there's a lot of market turmoil, that if you're selling concentrate to a customer that you're reliant on, if the market turns or politics turns or all sovereign risk turns, then basically you don't end up with a market. So that's the other advantage of copper cathode. It's a final finished product. And we're pretty unique because in Western Australia, there's no run really else that's doing or trying to do copper cathode on the mine side and then sell it straight into the market as a manufactured product. So we're unique there as well. So our whole strategy about what we're trying to achieve is unique. But notwithstanding, we get producing, we're making good money, which is what we intend to do. We're starting to build our other projects. And a larger company comes and makes an offer for us, and it's up to the shareholders to decide their own investment decision. So you never say no about what happens in the market, but ultimately our strategy will be consistently trying to move towards being a mid-term tier producer into that vacuum in Australia and sell copper cathode into the marketplace. So that won't change. But as I said, the market dictates what happens ultimately. And it is, look, you don't have to be a mathematician to calculate the undersupply of copper into the market and the future undersupply of copper into the market. It's not complicated mathematics. And in fact, a lot of the analysts you see out there who do lots of charts and things are, I reckon, are very poor at maths, because they're showing an increase in changes to energy and changes to vehicles, but they're not showing a parallel increase into the demand side. And if they do the mathematics on what they're showing on an increase in energy, increase in vehicles and things like that, then their chart on demand side would be much different. So there you go. There's a tip for the analysts that get to learn some maths.
I'm sure they'll be very grateful, Barry. That's great. No, it's been a real focus recently when I've been speaking to people in the market that copper really is something to be keeping an eye on. So let me wish you the very best of luck with it. And thank you very much for your time this morning.
No, thank you. It's been a pleasure.